It was actually an emptiness that I had felt my whole life, but it just really was very loud at that time. But that is like my most favorite thing about this Buddhism, is just like the treasuring of life. I was like, I'm gonna become like I just want to be so proud of the person that I am.
From SGI USA, I'm Cassidy Bradford, and this is Buddhability, the weekly series where I talk with Buddhists from all walks of life about the power we each have to change our lives and the world around us. Thank you so much, Nikki, for joining today on Buddhability. I'm glad we finally were able to make this work. We had many scheduling and technology troubles, but we are here. And I think that means it's just going to be a really incredible experience. So to kind of open the episode, you can just introduce yourself. So, you know, I already shared your name, but where you live, what you do for work, your age, and anything else you want to share about yourself.
Yes, totally. Hi, yeah, I'm so excited to be here. My name is Nikki Gonzalez, and I live in Oakland, California. I'm from the Bay Area, and currently, actually for work, I'm working in like experiential design, which is so cool and random. I have a history in social work, so, and I'm 32.
Well, yeah, just to get a sense of like who you are and some context for your experience, and especially like your experience with Buddhism, of course. Can you just tell me a little bit about like your life growing up and then how you encountered Buddhism?
Yeah, absolutely. So yeah, I grew up in San Francisco, and I love San Francisco so much. I have like a great love of the Bay Area. And I think growing up was both very exciting and also very chaotic. My home was very chaotic, I think. I have three amazing sisters. And yeah, we grew up in a small apartment. And yeah, it was very, I think, very full. But yeah, very also very challenging at times. I encountered Buddhism because my mom practiced. She was somebody shared with her in the 80s, and I was born in the early 90s. And she really was like, this practice was really the center of her life. And growing up, I was curious, and I attended different meetings or sometimes chanted with her. I actually didn't really start practicing until my early 20s. Yeah.
So like at what point in your early 20s, or I guess maybe like what was happening in your life that made you decide, okay, I think I'm gonna actually, you know, try this for real?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yes. So I really began practicing because my life had become very hard. I had recently turned 21 maybe. And my dad had just become incarcerated, and I had moved from the Bay Area to Oregon for a particularly challenging and not very healthy relationship that was very much falling apart in front of me. But I was so proud because so many people told me like it wasn't gonna work to go to Oregon, but I really, yeah, wanted something different in my life. And I just, you know, I got fired from my job, and I just felt like so scared and very unsure about how I could make it through. I was very on my own. So I just started chanting. So I connected with the local Buddhist organization and started attending meetings. And I really found that that was the way that actually I started to feel like kind of actually any sense of joy. Because at that time, I was just feeling so unsure and so empty and so sad. Like, I was so sad by my circumstances. And so, yeah, I really, at that point, began to really enjoy the philosophy of Buddhism. And from there, I really started to develop my own practice as, like, my own relationship to the practice.
Yeah. I mean, so many of us that like grow up around this practice, whether it's like family or close friends, it can for a while feel like, oh, this is somebody else's kind of, you know, practice or, you know, spirituality. Mm-hmm. But I think, yeah, for many folks that I talk to on Buddhability that grow up around this Buddhism, they always talk about, yeah, there was a point in time where I developed my own kind of relationship with this practice. And it was something that was really, yeah, my own. I had my ownership over it. It wasn't something that, like, my parent did or my sister or whatever. Yeah, we'll definitely be talking a lot about, like, self-love and self-worth today, and how looking for that, like, externally can really impact our lives. So I was wondering if you could just, like, help us get a better picture of, like, who you are and who you were. If you could tell me a bit about, like, how self-worth, like, or what self-worth looked like kind of growing up mm-hmm. and in your early 20s.
Yeah. I think very different than what it looks like now. But self-worth to me actually at that time was this very strict control over like people in my environment and myself, kind of. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was very strict with, you know, actually it's so interesting because I felt like I would actually very often be put in management positions at work, I think, because of this tendency.
Yep.
But yeah, I was very strict with people and I felt like it was very easy for me to say like, this is right and this is wrong. Like this is right behavior. This is wrong behavior. But very interestingly, I would then date men and that would not apply, or it would apply, but like, I wouldn't actually, like I would actually be okay with a lot of varying degrees of poor behavior. And yeah, so it was really interesting. I think I tried so hard because I felt like I had watched my mom not be treated very well by men and had felt like I would never let that happen to me. And then really watched that pattern happen to me, or like be a part of a dynamic like that for, yeah, actually for many, many years. So I think I was really trying desperately to ensure that that could never happen, but I hadn't really understood what it means to like really treasure my own life. So I kept being a part of situations where, you know, I would see like that disrespect happen.
And like when you were in those kind of situations and relationships, were you like aware, like, oh, this is, I'm replicating this thing that I don't want?
Yeah, I don't think I realized. I think I felt that as long as things look good, as long as people respect me, or like as long as people think, like don't see, then it's okay. That I think was like a big part. Like I'm not sure. I mean, people close to me would know, like this person is not respecting you, or but really, I think I tried really hard to hide that aspect, so that things like, yeah, so people could respect me based on like the image that I showed.
So it's like, yeah, not only self-worth based in like looking externally, but like putting up the image so that you get that like validation.
Yes. Wow. Like I'm very good at looking very good, I think.
Yes, like you're on the surface like, oh yeah, everything's great, and underneath you're like freaking out or like really, yeah, suffering. It's interesting though that you kind of couldn't see the reality of these relationships at the time. And I know in around like 2018 there was like a particularly challenging like relationship and situation where this kind of, yeah, maybe I'll say like manifested really clearly. Would you mind like telling, as much as you want, like telling that story?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think what's interesting too is, you know, partially I couldn't see it, but also partially my view of my life was very limited. And what I could, like what was possible to me was very limited. So I had been, very seriously dating this guy who I loved and who, yeah, not a bad person, right? And actually was the best so far. Like I had really found the best so far. And we had really built a life together. Like we bought a house and had a dog and I had a ring and we were, you know, like working toward marriage. And so on the surface looked very good.
Yeah.
Like I remember thinking I just remember feeling like, oh, I've made it.
Hmm. Yep.
I've done it. I've created what I was like supposed to create, or like I've created the stability I've always craved.
Hmm.
But actually, like within our relationship and just inside the home, mm-hmm. like was very he was very up and down and couldn't really ever decide. Hmm. So I kept thinking like, oh, if we could just get married, then it's okay if he never decides. Or like if I just get married, then I don't have to worry about like going to school or like pursuing these things in my life that were like really challenging. Or like if I can just help him do this thing, then, you know, then I'll be happy. So it was a lot of like, it looks very good externally, but like I was really looking for like, how can I become happy through him or through like, actually really through him.
Yep.
Yeah.
What did your practice look like at this time in your life?
Yes. So I practice very off and on. I would chat and support other people and attend meetings very furiously for a little bit. And then very quickly would kind of like fall off and then maybe not practice for a few months. Something I've always appreciated about our Buddhist communities, I was always really welcomed back. Mm. And I was really just consistently supported no matter what. And yeah, I never, you know, maybe I had my own guilt because like, that's just, I think what happens, but that was never a part of, everybody just supported me so fully and like with such an open heart mm-hmm. and gave me an opportunity to try and try and try again. So that's what my like practice looked like. I rarely chanted every day. Sometimes I would chant every day, sometimes not, but yeah, I loved the philosophy and I cared so deeply for like social justice. So I felt like this would give me an opportunity to contribute to that. Mm. But somewhere in my heart, I really did not believe that either I could become happy or that my father's really like enduring incarceration would like ever end. And so I think like it was like really hard for me to continue engaging.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's really what it was like. Yeah. At the time, very off and on.
And when you were chanting about things, like, what kind of things were you chanting about? Were you chanting about your relationship, about your dad, school, work?
Yeah, I was wishing a lot. I think, like, I was, like, wishing that things could be different. And, yeah, I really wanted my dad to be happy. And I wanted to be a good daughter. And I would chant. Also, I would chant for my partner to be happy so he could be better. And then I would chant.
Oh, I've been there.
Yeah. It was all over the place, honestly. And I think sometimes I chanted with great determination, like, I'm going to transform my life. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I chanted just like desperately hoping.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, I think chanting actually was the hardest part of practice for me. Like, I loved going to meetings, and that was very easy for me. But facing my own life, like, chanting in front of the Gohonzon in any kind of regularity was, like, woof.
Yeah.
Very hard. Yeah. I avoided that the most, I think.
Yeah, you know, there's so many people I talk to for the show that talk about, like, yeah, the courage that it can sometimes take to chant and really, like, face your life. And, of course, chanting isn't always this painful, excruciating thing. Like, chanting can be incredibly joyful, too. But, you know, sometimes when you're really, like, going through something really very deep in your life, something that's really kind of, like, at the core of your suffering, it can be hard to, like, oof, okay, I have to face that because I find for myself, it means like I really have to pull courage and hope out of my life that anything can change. Sometimes it's like I'm just resigned to like, oh, this is the reality. So, you know, why even challenge myself to really like try and transform this? For many of us, it's kind of like a part of our human revolution or our inner transformation of like learning how to be able to like bring this determination out of our lives. And sometimes it starts as just like, I'm just desperately wishing this thing will change. I don't believe that it can, but I'm just going to wish for it. So with all of that kind of, going on in your life and your practice kind of, pushing and pulling, what happened with the relationship?
Well, it's actually, so we ended up breaking up. He let me, it was so funny too, because it was like the day before we were going to send out invitations for our wedding. And I had sensed something, this like hesitation, but actually every hurdle that we went through together, there was always this hesitation from him. So I thought like, oh, this will just be the same. But he was like very serious. So we did not send out the invitations and we canceled the wedding. And I actually went home to the Bay Area for a little bit. And I remember sharing with my friend, like, you know, I know it's over, but it's just going to take me like some time to leave. And so it took me about like 6 months. And actually in that time, I also became pregnant. And then very quickly had a like very traumatic ectopic pregnancy. It was just like, my suffering was so, I felt like my suffering was so great. I had also, you know, had a lot of hope that, oh, I'm pregnant now. So like, not even that him and I would stay together, but I had, like, I felt like, oh, this is my like way out, kind of. Like, this is my way, path to happiness is through this baby, through this life. So it was like very, when I had that ectopic pregnancy and actually like physically was very challenging. I felt that was kind of this like ripping of reality, like this kind of like first tear in this image that I had that anything could be external. And I felt like this emptiness much more acutely. It was actually an emptiness that I had felt my whole life, but it just really was very loud at that time. And actually very quickly after that, him and I decided to break up, and I ended up moving home to San Francisco.
Thank you for sharing, because I know that's like deeply personal and a very painful experience, which actually like I think many young people go through, but we don't talk about it all that often. But it's really like, I can't imagine the sort of weight or heaviness of like sort of building your life. Like, oh, these things will make me happy. These things will make me like really value my life, love my life. And then to have them all kind of like pulled away and in a very traumatic way, like I can't imagine the kind of pain you must have been experiencing. Like, how did you heal? How did you just like live?
Yeah, so I moved home with my mom. I was 29. It was kind of like the eve of turning 30. And I remember telling my friend, like, I just am so tired of my life being so hard. Like, I had felt like my whole life I had like tried to do the right thing, but like, it had just never really happened. And I was just like, I'm so tired of my life being so hard. And and just so much suffering. Like, up until that point, I felt like my life had just been like one, like suffering, like deep suffering after another. And, And so, but I actually, you know, like, frankly, like I felt like I just don't want to keep going. Like, what would be the point in me continuing on? I remember sharing that with her. But I knew that I was going to keep going. So I felt like, okay, I might as well try Buddhism again. Like, I might as well, like, really just try, because like I didn't feel like there just didn't seem to be anything else that offered me any kind of like relief from suffering or like any kind of any hope filled teaching that really felt like accurate or like could actually help me. Or I actually didn't even see anybody outside of our Buddhist community doing like transforming suffering the way I saw people in our Buddhist community transforming suffering. So I thought like, okay, I'll try again. And that was really when I just decided to give 100%. And I was very fortunate because I had moved in with my mom. And although that was like its own big challenge, she never skips chanting. She chants morning and evening. And so, yeah, I was able to, like, really with her support, I think, like, build that rhythm again. And, yeah, it really just, like, opened a door for me.
So as that, like, door is opening and you're like, okay, I'm going to give 100%. Was there anything that, like, you were really studying or any action you were taking or way that you were chanting that was kind of helping you, like, propel yourself forward, or might not even be propel, help yourself, like, inch forward, crawl a centimeter a day? Yeah.
Yeah. It really felt like survival at that point. And it also felt like, I just felt like such a shell. Like, my whole entire life had been based on this, like, image of, like, I have the husband and the house and the dog. Like, this, it looked very good. And I was like, I had done such a good job. And then that had been taken away. And I actually felt like, I don't know who I am. I don't know. Like, I literally, like, when I felt inside, there was, like, nothing in there. And So I felt like chanting and, like, going to Buddhist activities were what made me feel like a person in those moments that I was, like, interacting. And, of course, like, my friends and, you know, different things. But it was really, yeah. I'll share, actually, my most favorite. This is from Daisaku Ikeda, who is really my mentor. And he shares in this amazing book called Discussions on Youth. That I actually thought I was too old for because it's for high school students, but turns out we all suffer and have angst and, like, really are concerned about our future at any age. But he talks about in this section called What is Love? There's two sections in here that really helped me through this time, but every morning I used to read this from Daisaku Ikeda, and he shares, it is crucial that you become strong. If you are strong, even your sadness will become a source of nourishment, and the things that make you suffer will purify your lives. Only when we experience the crushing, painful depths of suffering can we begin to understand the true meaning of life. Precisely because we have experienced great suffering, it is imperative that we go on living. The important thing is to keep moving forward. If each of you uses your sadness as a source of growth, you will become a person of greater depth and breadth, an even more wonderful you. This is the harvest of your pain and suffering. Then he says, hold your head high because you have lived with all your might. You are victors. Mm. And I just, like, every morning I would just, like, cry, or, like, cry in my heart and, like, read this. And just say, like, okay, like, I can keep going. And that I, you know, like, this suffering can help me become strong. And there was some part of me that knew that. Like, I knew that I could be a strong person because of all of my suffering. But I needed to, like, take this, like, next step. And so every time I really read this, I was just like, okay, like, this is not for nothing. Like, this pain that I feel can help me become somebody so strong. Yeah, and so I really, like, every morning would read that and just, like, one foot in front of the other.
Yeah, I love that you said, like, some part of you knew that, like, yes, this can make me stronger. Because I think all of us, I don't know, maybe I shouldn't generalize every single person, but I think many of us, like, have that sort of push and pull. You know, there's this part of us, which, you know, is really our Buddhahood, our enlightened nature, that can see the true, you know, aspect of our reality, that we have this enlightened nature and we really can transform any suffering. But of course, like, we have these other parts of ourselves every day that tell us we're not good enough, or, you know, this person doesn't like me, I can never achieve this. But I think that's why chanting and studying, especially, like, consistently, like you were doing, are so crucial. It's like the way to sort of, like, bring that enlightenment, that voice, that part of ourselves that says we can do it, bring that out, make it stronger and stronger and stronger.
If that didn't already exist within me, then that those words would mean nothing.
Yeah.
But there was like a part of me that like was like, I do have this within me. So it was like, oh, it was like, I think like that's what's so amazing about like having Daisaku Ikeda as a mentor and like really practicing like based on the Lotus Sutra is that it's calling to something that already exists within my life. It's not like, otherwise my body would be like, that's not you. Like, there's no like, you can't be strong. But there was a part of me that was like, I like, this is true. Like I can be strong, or like I can even be happy. There was like, so anyway, it was just really, that portion, even if I'm struggling right now, like not in love, but I do like come back to
I have like a couple of things that like I always gravitate to in the moments where I'm just like, wow, I never have felt this depleted before. I've never felt this, you know, when I'm just at my lows. And then even if like I can't really bring myself to chant, okay, but at least I'm going to read just a little bit, something that can like, speak to that part of myself that's kind of like hidden away, but is still there. You had mentioned earlier that, you know, your dad was in prison, and I'm wondering like what happened with that, or was anything moving at that time?
Yeah. The trial, the many trials, or, you know, he had lasted like 10 years. It had almost become this thing that felt like impossible. Mm-hmm. But we had made many strides, and even like I had set many goals throughout my practice, even when I was practicing very inconsistently, like he'll be out by the end of the year. And then, you know, I would make many causes and chant so much, and then it wouldn't happen. And so much heartache, but really, and even actually my, my partner at that time, his family was from where my dad was incarcerated. So I was able to actually like travel to go see my dad. It was like, I felt very protected by that. I had really come to this place where I had continued chanting and continued making causes and, you know, efforts in my Buddhist practice really as this effort also for his happiness. And, but it felt almost like a little bit distant for me, but still I was fighting. And then, he was in his kind of final trial, and I had even like flown out with my sisters to, support and testify for him, and came home. So in this, it had really felt like this enduring challenge. But I think when I moved home, it was really beginning to believe like, oh, I can be happy and my family can be happy. And the efforts of many people, but actually he was like fully released and exonerated in February of 2020. Wow. So also right before the pandemic. So it was like really just so, I felt like so much protection, and he has an amazing partner who really like allowed him to come home and support him. And it was really, cause I was really chanting like, unsure how it would go if he even was released and what would happen after at that point. And he began practicing in June of 2022. I think it just for so long, I think my life had been wrapped up in this battle, I felt like actually almost like in this holding pattern, like holding situation, where it was very hard to like move on. And so it was really actually, now that I think about it, very mystic that it really aligned with this like focus on myself, like my life, and like really treasuring my life. And then he got out, and then it like opened this like new chapter for me, where I was like, okay, who am I without like this person who's like, you know, flying to go see him, or like constantly waiting to hear what will happen, or like what will be the verdict on the rest of his life. Yeah, it was incredibly, I don't know, like freeing. I felt like we had many challenges still ahead, but really aligned in my life of this, like, okay, there's no more waiting for happiness now, or there's no more like waiting. It's just now. Absolutely. Your time.
I think a lot of people can relate to the feeling of like having someone in your life or something that it's like sort of not moving, right? And it feels like our life is going to be like anchored to this thing. Like we can't fully, you know, move forward till it shifts. So, I think a lot of people can relate with that kind of experience. And of course, there are always more challenges that happen after that. But it is really incredible that, like, timing wise, it really coincided with this, like, fresh departure for your own life too. So as you're like, surviving and like moving one little step forward every moment, did you start noticing like any changes like in your environment, in yourself?
Yeah, one thing is like my ex and I had been off and on and he really went away, which I did not enjoy, but we ended up like, it was like I had gone even up to Oregon to like try to like see him, and actually it was so challenging and I was chatting so much at that time because I had like taken this guidance and I was like, I, you know, also in this book, Daisaku Kate, it talks about like becoming a person that you would be proud to be with. And I felt like, okay, I want to become that person. And really understanding this oneness of self and environment. Like, I need to become this strong person so that I can be with somebody strong. And so, I had gone up and it had gone so terribly. And I was chanting so much. He also was, like, a member. So anyway, I was chanting, like, so much. And I just remember thinking, like, I don't want to suffer over this anymore. I don't know the answer. I mean, I did know the answer, but I did not want the answer. Like, I still did not want that. But I was like, I just don't want to suffer over this anymore. I'm tired of this brand of suffering. Like, can we go on to the next one is how I felt. So I was just like chanting like, okay, Gohonzon, like, I'm ready. Like, I'll be courageous. Like, I just don't want to suffer over this anymore. And, it went so terribly. It was so painful. And then at the end, he was like, I don't want to be with you anymore. And I was like, okay, fine. Like, I just was like, okay, fine. And then, you know, because he had still been living in the house and there had been roommates. And, like, we had really left things very open, which was how our whole relationship had been. So, we were like, okay, it's time to, like, sell the house. And, and we did. And it actually, I just... You know, even though things between him and I could be very strained, I just chanted, like, I just want to be so proud of the way we end things. Like, I just want to create value, even though we're breaking up, even though, like, you know, this is so painful. I want to really create value, even from this situation. I want to be so proud of how I've, like, of how we do this together. And so actually it was during the pandemic. And so like the sky was, remember when the sky, there was like a point when like the sky was red and, you know, we're on the West Coast. And there were times where he would call me and say like, Nikki, the house isn't ready. And but the fires were so crazy. I couldn't get up there to do it for him. So I had to like just really chant. And so I would chant like a lot every day. And just make many causes, but just like study. And I also had decided I didn't want to control people anymore. I just really wanted to trust the universe or trust my practice or trust my prayer. So I was like, he would call me and say like, you know, it's not ready or like different challenging things. And instead of being like, you know, like, what's wrong with you? Like, why can't you do this? Or like trying to even step in, I would just say, okay, like, don't worry. I'll chant. And we ended up selling the house, like, amidst that craziness, like, red sky. People were coming to see it in, like, this red sky. It was, like, so wild. But we sold, and we sold, like, above asking, and we split it evenly. And at the end, he shared, like, you know, we both just really thanked each other for, like, our life together. And we're just, like, I'm so proud of the way we've ended things. And, it was actually really quite beautiful. It was a challenge even like that whole day. But I just kept like deciding like I'm not gonna suffer the same way anymore. It was actually really incredible.
You know, that's so amazing. Like, I've talked to like a couple of people too that like when they've talked about, like, the stress or heart, like, the pain of a breakup, but because they were really, like, fighting really hard in their practice, like, it ends up being like, wow, you know, like, actually that was so wonderful. I mean, of course, wonderful in the context of a breakup that is painful, but
yeah,
I even remember one time I was dating someone and I was like, oh, do they like me, do they not? And I started really chanting seriously, like, okay, I just want to see this relationship for what it is. And they broke up with me that, like, a couple days later. And I cried on the train home. And then as soon as I got home, I was like, well,
yeah,
this is what I chanted for. So obviously this is not the right, you know, person for me. Okay. You know, but
clear.
I felt like at that time I had really transformed so much internally that was kind of like just the external almost result of like, oh, okay, cool.
Yeah.
Like, this is it. Not at all to compare a, you know, couple of months dating to your experience, but just, like, we can sometimes see so clearly our human revolution in our relationships, right?
Yeah.
Like, somebody that you're on and off again with, or, you know, you're really clinging to trying to control something to get to a place that is like, wow, I'm really just going to trust my chanting. I'm going to trust myself. And when you can, like, yeah, let go in that sense. And I feel like that is really strength. Yeah. So then after things end, was it like, wow, my whole life has changed and, like, everything's easy and I've got this great relationship? Like, what did the next sort of, like, phase look like after that?
Yes. It's not quite like that.
We like to keep it real on Bootability.
I stayed in, actually, when I remember signing the papers, I stayed in bed for a couple days. But I was just like a different person and I had this different view. And I think this is when my prayer really shifted from like, how do I survive, to like, who am I and what kind of life am I trying to like build for myself? Like internal life, really. Like, I think that selling of that, like that kind of closing really helped me to get to this point of like, actually the way that I feel inside is the most important in this phase. That's how I felt like in this phase. And that guidance that Daisaku Ikeda shares, like, become a person that you would be proud to be with. I was like, I'm gonna become like I just want to be so proud of the person that I am. And so I actually just chanted like that. And also I still, and I also really chanted to like treasure my life. Yeah. Like, I, you know, that is, like, my most favorite thing about this Buddhism is just, like, the treasuring of life. Like, one life is more precious than all the major world systems. That's what the Lotus Sutra says that we base our practice on. Like, that is, like, so important to me. But I really wanted to believe that about myself. And, so I just chanted every day, I just want to believe what Daisaku Ikeda says about my life. I want to believe that my life is this precious treasure. Yeah, I would just chant like, go home. So, like, I just want to really treasure my life. At that time, I really started to engage much more actively in Buddhist activities and like support other young women and non-binary folks. And I just like, I was able to actually do so much in our Buddhist community that I was like, oh my God, Nikki, like, you're so capable. Like, my history had been this, like, I would try to go to school and then drop out and try to go to school and drop out and try to go, like, very, like, up and down. But I had shown so much consistency in my Buddhist practice that I was like, oh my God, Nikki, like, you could go to school. Like, you could finish one term of school. So I, re-registered for classes and had, like, my first term where I received A's and, like, made it to the end, and even had done this presentation on, like, education and how our philosophy is actually rooted in education. And my teacher had said, like, can I show this to other people? So I felt like it was incredible. I was like, I have like one, and it was challenging. And there were many points that I wanted to give up, but I had learned that I was a person who could follow through. and not give up on myself. Like, through really engaging in Buddhist activities, I really learned, like, oh, I am a strong person who can, you know, can really fight for my own happiness, which also means, like, doing my homework or going to class when I'm embarrassed, or, you know, like, I just had a lot of anxiety around school. So, yeah, it was really, I think, like, that was kind of something for myself. I dated people along the way, but there was this, like, very tight hold that I had on, like, my Buddhist activities really being this driving force for what was really in my heart, like, what I really wanted.
Wow, it sounds like that was kind of the way that you were able to, yeah, stay, like, I don't know what the right word is, but, like, grounded, like, in what you really want in your life. Okay, I know these are the things that, like, propel my life forward and, like, help me, like, really remind myself exactly, like, the kind of life that I want to live. And I also love that you said you had learned that you were somebody that could follow through. Because I think, yeah, oftentimes, or I don't know, I think, like, throughout our lives and our Buddhist practice, we learn how capable we are through experience, right? That's why the things that are really, you know, painful, like the depths of sadness we can experience, the heartbreak, the grief, whatever, when we can really, like, make it to the other side and feel, like, victorious, then, yeah, we really learn, like, wow, I am somebody that's so capable. So I know that, you know, all of these, like, kind of things are happening. Your life is kind of expanding, I guess I'll say. And you started dating someone. And there's some more things that kind of, yeah, unfold after that, if you want to share a little bit about that story.
Yeah, so I, you know, I had really, I think, like, focused on, like, myself, but I was still dating. I don't think I was ever truly single, honestly. I think, like, some people say that that's what you need, but I just practiced, and I just, like, yeah, I just did my Buddhist practice.
Yeah, everybody has their own way.
On the side. Like, I really loved this quote, and it's also actually in this What is Love section. I think my whole life has been built on this, like, what is love? But Daisaku Ikeda, like, talks about, like, working on polishing yourself first. But he shares, like, if you genuinely love someone, then through your relationship with him or her, you can develop into a person whose love extends to all humanity. Such a relationship serves to strengthen, elevate, and enrich your inner realm of life. Ultimately, the relationships you form are a reflection of your own state of life. And he said, you know, like, this is true of friendship as well. Like, only to the extent that you polish yourself now can you hope to develop wonderful bonds of the heart in the future. But this one part where he says, you can develop into a person whose love extends to all humanity. And I felt like even then my heart was still kind of closed. And so this idea that I could, like, love all humanity, like, through my love that I have for, like, one person or even, you know, like, my family. But I just wanted that kind of love, like, to really love somebody in this open-hearted way that made me, yeah, love all. I just loved that, like, loving all of humanity, and I wanted to be that kind of open person, which would have been, like, the first time in my life I had ever experienced that. So I think then, you know, when I was, like, dating, I still dated people who were, like, not quite the right fit. I was really, like, it was really trial and error. But then I met somebody, and he actually just really supported me. And I still felt very unsure because he was very different than people I had dated in the past. So I just used my practice. Like that, like you're sharing, like, you know, you chant so that, you know, it can become clear. And so I just, like, chanted, like, as long as but I had this trust in my life. Like, as long as I keep my Buddhist practice at the center, then it will become very clear if this is, like, the right person for me or not. So I would just chant, like, I want to see, like, is this the right person or not? Because I still had such low trust in myself to be able to decide. So I was just like, I'll find out. So I just chanted that way, and then we kept going and kept going and kept going, and kept being like very lovely. So now it's been almost like wow. 3 years, a little over 2 years. And of course, like challenges mm-hmm. come up, but to me, like, this is actually a universally, like, different relationship than I've ever mm-hmm. been in. And he really supports my Buddhist practice, which I think also means, like, really supporting me. And, I'm also pregnant, which is very exciting. And even, earlier in the year, I had become pregnant and had miscarried and had felt like, again, that feeling of like, why me and why is life so hard? And yeah, we can chant for many years or chant very sincerely, but still like that feeling comes up sometimes. And so I had been chanting like, why me? And am I just going to have to battle this, fertility journey? Is this going to be like my new battle? And I was like very angry about that. But actually, like, I just kind of kept chanting, and the Buddhist community, like, really supported me. And, my partner really supported me. And I actually, for the first time, really learned how to allow people to care for me, and particularly him. Mm. And, you know, like, he stayed home and, he, like, cried with me. And it was just, like, so I felt like actually this life that I've built for myself through my Buddhist practice and like really developing myself as a person, it reflects this like love and care that I really like at the core of my being, this like love that I wanted to have for like many people and like humanity. Like I was really able to experience that through like the people in my life. And actually, yeah, I had just felt like my whole life, like I'm alone. And like that experience, even when I had first gotten pregnant, I felt this like huge fear. Like, I'm gonna like have to do this alone is how I felt. Or that at the end of the day, there's only me. And so when this happened and I was able to experience like so much love and support and just really seeing that my life had changed so much, I actually was like so beautiful that I had like so much appreciation for like that experience. And I feel like it actually really prepared me this time for like this pregnancy. And when I got pregnant this time, I do not feel that fear. Of course, like there's like practical things that come up that I feel like, oh God, what am I gonna do when that happens? but in general, like I have this solid foundation and this view of like, yes, challenges will arise in my life and my life will probably not go smoothly. And I'm sure when we introduce a child, like that will be its own set of like suffering and challenges and hardship. But really like any suffering that exists can be transformed into such a depth of happiness or like really just like a deeper understanding of life. Like I feel much more ready for life at this point. And I think if that hadn't happened, I'm not sure that I would be ready in the way that I am now. But not just that happening, but really like working through it with my Buddhist practice, like, you know, like the chanting and being supported and things like that and studying. So yeah, it was, that's a very like long answer, I think, to your question. But, when I as particularly like look back at my early 20s or like even because it's only been I think a few years that I've really been seriously practicing, maybe like three years that I've like consistently been like it hasn't been so long, but feels like a lifetime of effort really that I've put in. But I just have so much appreciation for actually my whole entire life, like every single moment of my life led me to like this person that I am now. Or like every suffering is actually this great treasure and has allowed me to experience this like profound joy and happiness that I, would never have believed was possible.
I feel a little speechless, Nikki. It's like so incredible, especially I think many young people struggle to feel hope that they can develop that kind of sense of self. I know I definitely did. You know, I really yeah. had similar kind of feelings of this, like, hollowness of my life. Like, but every time I chanted, somehow my life felt like just like pulsating alive, you know, even when it's like painful. But to hear your experience and know that, like, yeah, there were many like very challenging things along the way, but to hear you say like those are now part of this like treasure of your life because they've helped you develop into this kind of person, that kind of shift, like really fundamental shift in the way that we view ourselves and our lives, in my opinion or my experience, is only possible through chanting. You know, otherwise, like, yes, we can, you know, to a certain extent, like, practice, you know, things, but I feel like this kind of like, yeah, core of our life shift and like developing that strength really for me only comes from chanting and studying and doing Buddhist activities. And so I have like a last question about a piece of advice. I'm wondering what piece of advice you would have for someone listening right now who's just really struggling with self-worth.
I think there's an element in the beginning of chanting that is a little bit, like, it feels good, but it's not going to feel good every single time. And then sometimes, you know, like, not that it, like, feels, but just, like, that your life still happens, right? Even though you're chanting. And I think, like, just holding hope that even if I don't feel that right now, even if I don't actually even know what it means to treasure my life, or, like, even, you know, like, there's things that I still feel like I'm like, what does that mean to really respect myself? Or what does that mean to really, like, care deeply for my life? And, but, like, I just chanted, like, I want to be that person. And I think that was something that I really held on to when I was chanting, is, like, I had no idea what that looked like. I don't think I had even really seen an example of that in my life, like, so far. Really, so I had no idea, but I wanted to know. And then so I was like, I just want to know, like, I just want to be that person who can, like, really treasure my life. And I think Daisaku Ikeda is such an incredible mentor, because there's never the writing always shares, like, you have everything within you, but that's, like, a very nice idea. So just, like, I just really chanted, like, I want to believe what this Buddhism says about my life. I want to really feel that for myself. And just, like, I think those, like, measured steps forward, or, like, that kind of continuous effort led me out. But I think holding on to hope for yourself is, like, the most crucial thing.